Y'all can have a seat. Y'all saw how scared the staff were of me, right? I walk up behind John. Y'all see that? Man. Either that or they don't trust me. It's probably the latter. This morning, we're talking about a subject that will be very close to all of us, because if any of us have endeavored to do anything for God, there's one thing that we're going to come up against, and that is discouragement. Discouragement is this thing that has a way of keeping us from doing what the Lord has for us. Discouragement can come in very subtle ways, and if we're not careful, we have to be really careful, because sometimes we let ourselves get discouraged a little bit too easily. Like this morning, I could have been discouraged. I walked in. First thing Nathan Miller says to me is, "Boy, Pastor, you look tired." Jason walks in 2 seconds later and says, "Dude, you look like Nacho Libre this morning." Apparently because of the blue sweater vest. And then I realize they've given me no way to get off the stage. I don't even know what that means. And so I could be discouraged today. But I'm not going to be. I'm going to choose something better, right? And the reality is, this is something that the church needs to understand and needs to hear. Not just our church, the church as a whole. Because, folks, as we continue in the Lord's will, we're going to find that we aren't on a playground, are we? That's not what we've been put here to do. We're not here to be entertained. We're not here just to have some fun. The reality is we've been left here with a mission, because the souls of men matter. And there is a war going on for the souls of men. And so for us as believers, we have to realize that we literally, in every way, are on a spiritual battleground for the souls of men. The devil knows that he can't win, but it doesn't stop him from trying. He hasn't come to grips with the truth of the gospel. And for every step we take doing what God has told us to do, he's going to come against us. And that is what is happening in the life of Nehemiah when we get to chapter 4. As we have been going through this book, God has been doing some amazing things in the life of Nehemiah. He called him out from the position that he had serving King Artaxerxes, and literally, as the king released him to go accomplish the rebuilding of the Jerusalem walls, he went with the blessing of the king. He went with the money of the king to go and do this. When he went to the people, you would have thought that they wouldn't listen to some outsider, but as he shared his heart and as he poured out what God had spoken to him about what God wanted to do amidst his people in Jerusalem, the people got behind the vision and the direction, and we come to this chapter and we realize that the construction of the wall has begun. But not everybody's happy about it. Not everybody is going to clap for that. And folks, we do realize, and most of us have a pretty, you know, sometimes life can beat you down to the point you get a pretty cynical look at life. And we think of everything that could go wrong, we think in our mind it will go wrong, and usually it seems to go wrong all at once. That's what you would think when you come to chapter 4 in the book of Nehemiah. I want to read to you the entire thing this morning. And I want to read it before we get into it, rather than breaking it down point by point. I want to look at the chapter as a whole this morning about how do we recognize discouragement? How do we recognize how the devil uses it as a tool and a weapon against us? And how do we survive criticism and discouragement? That's what we're going to deal with today. It begins by saying, "Now it came about when Sanballat heard that we were rebuilding the wall, he became furious." And not just furious, it goes on and says that he became very angry. So he's heaping these words on to give you the idea that these dudes are freaking out. He is not happy, okay? And he's so unhappy, he's going to do something about it. It says, "And he began to mock the Jews. He spoke in the presence of his brothers and the wealthy men of Samaria, and he said, 'What are these feeble Jews doing? Are they going to restore it for themselves? Can they offer sacrifices? Can they finish this in a day? Can they revive the stones from the dusty rubble, even the burned ones?' Now Tobiah the Ammonite was near him, and he said, 'Even what they are building, if a fox should jump on it, he would break their stone wall down.'" When you get to verse 4, it starts something new. You almost miss it Nehemiah is hearing these words. The people are hearing these words. And verse 4 goes into a prayer. Nehemiah prays, "Hear, O our God, how we are despised. Return their reproach on their own heads and give them up for the plunder in a land of captivity. Do not forgive their iniquity and let not their sin be blotted out before you, for they have demoralized the builders. So we built the wall, and the whole wall was joined together to half its height, for the people had a mind to work." Now when Sanballat, Tobiah, the Arabs, the Ammonites, and the Ashdodites heard that the repair of the walls of Jerusalem went on, that the breaches began to be closed, they were very angry. And all of them conspired together to come and fight against Jerusalem and to cause a disturbance in it. But we prayed, the second time he prayed, to our God, and because of them, we set up a guard against them day and night. Then in Judah it was said, "The strength of the burden bearers is failing, and there is much rubbish, and we ourselves are unable to rebuild the wall. Our enemies said, 'They will not know or see until we come among them, kill them, and put a stop to the work.' When the Jews who lived near them came and told us 10 times, 'They will come up against us from every place where you may turn,' I stationed men in the lowest parts of the space behind the wall, the exposed places. I stationed people and families with swords, spears, and bows. When I saw their fear, I rose and spoke to the nobles, the officials, and the rest of the people. 'Do not be afraid of them. Remember the Lord who is great and awesome, and fight for your brothers, your sons, your daughters, your wives, your houses.' When our enemies heard that it was known to us and that God had frustrated their plan, then all of us returned to the wall, each one to his work. From that day on, half of his servants carried on the work, half of them with spears, shields, bows, and the breastplates, and the captains were behind the whole house of Judah. Those who were rebuilding the wall and those who carried burdens, they took their load with one hand doing the work and on the other hand holding a weapon. As for the builders, each wore his sword girded at his side as he built, while the trumpeter stood near me. I said to the nobles, the officials, and the rest of the people, 'The work is great, and it is extensive, and we are separated on the wall from far from one another. At whatever place you hear the sound of the trumpet, rally to us there. Our God will fight for us.' So we carried on the work, with half of them holding spears from dawn until the stars appeared. At the same time, I also said to the people, 'Let each man with his servant spend the night within Jerusalem, so that they may be on guard for us by night and a laborer by day, so neither I, my brothers, my servants, nor the men who guard, nor the men of the guard who followed me, none of us removed our clothes. Each took his weapon, even to the water." All you can say as you read this is it's obvious that the opponents of Nehemiah, the opponents really not of Nehemiah, but of what God was trying to do, they obviously have not taken kindly to the miraculous progress that has been made. In chapter 2, we get introduced to the characters of this chapter. Not just Nehemiah, who was introduced in 1, but Sanballat, Tobiah, all these other people, the Arabs that are mentioned here, all of these people, they basically have come to conspire against the Jews. The reality is, they're frustrated. When they first saw the Jews come into Jerusalem, when they first heard of the plans that Nehemiah had, when they started to understand that this great rebuilding was going to occur, in the beginning, they mocked. In the beginning, they kind of laughed at them, but I don't think they took real serious the work that was going to be done. And I don't think they could have imagined how quickly this work would be done. They went from coming in, rallying the people, to suddenly we find in this chapter that half of the wall has been built. The entire thing will be built in 52 days, which is just about a miracle considering how large this wall was. And as the enemies of God are watching, they are not pleased with what they see. The first thing I want you to see this morning as we talk about discouragement and criticism is that we as believers must expect criticism. We must expect discouragement and we have to be ready for it. Expect it. Be ready for it. You see, the reality is criticism can be avoided. In your life, you know, we're saying expect it. We're saying it's coming. But there is a reality. That is for the man of God who is endeavoring to do the will of God. If that is you, then it is coming. You say, well, how can I avoid discouragement? How can I avoid criticism? It's very easy. Do nothing. Say nothing. Become nothing. And you'll never have to hardly experience it. But if you want your life to count for eternity, if you want to be able to hear the Lord say, well done, thou good and faithful servant, if you want to get about the Great Commission, if you want to get about doing world missions, if you want to get about diving into the ugly places of people's lives to encourage them and to teach them and to disciple them and to bring them into maturity, I'm going to go ahead and tell you something right now. A man who does something, says something, and desires to become something with God in him, through him, let me tell you something, it's coming. It's inevitable. Why? Because of spiritual warfare. Now, somebody asked me this week as I was talking to them about what we're going to be speaking on, and they asked me the question, well, isn't some criticism good? Well, the reality is, yes. There is such a thing in our lives called constructive criticism, right? It means that everything that we do in ways needs to be evaluated. But here is the thing that we have to understand as believers in Jesus Christ. If we're not careful, we leave constructive criticism very quickly and it just becomes criticism. It's very easy to do. And most of the time, we don't even mean to do it. But there is a vast difference between what we're talking about in chapter 4. There is nothing constructive about it. There is nothing encouraging about it. This is meant to stop the work. This is meant to be a discouragement. What we have to realize as believers, and never forget this, church, your words will direct the lives of the people around you. You don't know you have a superpower, but you do. Words. The words you speak to your children will direct the course of their life. Let that sink in a second. The words you speak to your spouse will direct the course of his or her life. You see, there's a truth about our words that the words we speak, they only can accomplish one or two things. They're either going to build up or they're going to tear down. Folks, that's it. They're either going to encourage or they're going to discourage. And you realize that the calling that we have as believers in Christ is even when we get to a place where we recognize that something's wrong and we need to go to a person and we need to speak truth to that person, what is the balance to truth? Love. It's always been, and it always will be, love. Truth without love, you'll never reach the person. And if you give nothing but love without any truth whatsoever, you'll never see the person change. But when you can put truth and love together, it's a beautiful thing. When the person knows that you're coming to them and you love them and you care for them and you have their best interest in mind, they will receive the criticism that is brought and it won't be a discouragement. It can be an encouragement even though it is critical. I love the way one pastor put it. He said that criticism should be like rain that is gentle enough to nourish a man's growth without destroying his roots. I heard it put this way when I was much younger. Sandwich every bit of criticism between two layers of praise. It was a little rougher when I heard it, but that was the gist. I just prettied it up for us. Do you realize that for every time you tell someone what they're doing wrong, you ought to be able to sit down with them as well and praise them for what they're doing right? Because if all they ever hear from us is what's wrong, guess what happens? Your criticism quickly becomes discouragement. And so, folks, understand that even within the body of Christ, discouragement can come. Criticism can come. Does it make us better? Does it strengthen us? Folks, we have to realize the enemies of God will do everything in their power to come against God, to come against God's work, to come against God's people. The devil will never sit idly by without a relentless fight. If you are doing the will of God, expect it. You say, well, what good is suffering? What good is trial? What good can come out of these moments? Why is God allowing them? You're saying that if we're in His will, then He's going to allow it. Well, number one, here's the mistake that we make when we think about suffering, when we think about criticism, when we think about the discouragement that comes with being in God's will. You need to remember, just because you're being discouraged or just because someone is trying to stop the work that you're doing, it doesn't mean that God's blessing isn't on the thing that you're doing. Don't take criticism, don't take ridicule, don't take intimidation, don't take all those things stop us from doing the will of God. We have to come to grips with, we can be in the will of God and all those things are happening and God has a purpose for them. I would say when it comes to this in our life, sometimes these things happening to us is the very evidence that God is actually blessing. And folks, I will tell you, when you see it rightly, they become an opportunity for your growth. You have no idea how much God will use criticism to grow you. Discouragement to grow you. Folks, what God puts in your life, He doesn't put there to destroy you. He puts there to refine you, to purify you, to strengthen you. Because in fact, that's what we see happening here. They are surrounded. It's not just Sanballat. It's not just Tobiah. It's not just Geshem and all these three people that we've met. You see what it says? It says that literally there is a huge group of people. All of their buddies are there and they're laughing and mocking and they're discouraging. It says that the wealthy men of Samaria, it probably is better translated, these are probably the military men, the leaders, the who's who of Samaria, not just wealthy men, but also literally that word almost translates army. But in the time, guess what? These men would have been the wealthy men, but these were the men that could make the stuff happen. And so they are surrounded. When you remember what people groups these men represent, it's the people to the north, it's the people to the south, it's the people to the west. Virtually, they are surrounded by people that don't want to see them succeed. Kind of feels like today, doesn't it? When it comes to the gospel. So what do? Do we just quit? When they say be quiet, do we just be quiet? When they say stop doing the work that you're doing, do we just stop? Secondly, we have to learn to recognize the tools and the devices that the enemy uses to discourage us. We've come to grips with the first point that we expect criticism and discouragement, and we got to be ready for it. And secondly, what are the tools that the enemy uses to discourage us? You see, it's important that we know them because you can't battle an enemy that you don't understand. You do realize that, right? And if you're going to win a battle, you have to understand the enemy. You have to understand what they're going to do, how they've moved. I mean, even if you take something like basketball, what do they do before basketball games or football games? They review tapes over and over and over, and they try to understand the defenses and the offenses, and they prepare, and they battle every team completely different, because if you don't know who it is you're battling, you probably are going to lose. Paul, if you go over to 2 Corinthians, it's interesting, in chapter 2, verse 11, he says the very same thing. He says he wants us to live, in verse 11, in such a way so that no advantage would be taken of us by Satan, for we are not ignorant of his schemes. He's saying if you don't want to be taken advantage of by our enemies, you have to be aware of the schemes. How they operate. The devil does not operate in any new way, in any fresh way. What we see in the garden, what we see in the wilderness, what we see in the lives of all the people in the Old Testament Scripture and the New Testament Scripture, we find that the devil has not changed his tactics. Why? Because they are very effective, because most of us don't know our enemy very well. What are some of the tactics that we see that he uses right here in these verses? Well, first of all, we see that he uses ridicule. Boy, this is the devil's native tongue. When you say we've got to know our enemy, listen, you know what the devil is? If you want to know him, he is a liar. Everything that comes out of his mouth, you know what it is? It's a lie. Think of how many times in Scripture he lied. He lied about Job. He lied about God in the garden. He lied about the way Jesus could be honored and praised if he would shortcut the cross. Over and over, the devil whispers in our ear and he lies. Literally, I mean, when you think of the word devil, do you know what it actually means? Diablo? Slanderer. Every time you gossip or slander, you know what you're actually doing? That's who the devil is. That's what he is. To the core of his being. He wants to distract you. He wants to sell you on a counterfeit. And let me tell you something, what he's really good at, making you feel like a fool. Making you feel like you've taken on too much. Making you feel like you're not able. He will come in and he will ridicule. He will come in and he will mock. He will use people to do that to you. When you think about what ridicule and when you think about what mockery is, literally that word, I mean, think of what he says. He begins by saying, in the presence of all these men, they're all sitting around laughing at the Jews, pointing at the Jews, whispering about the Jews, yelling out at the Jews. What are these feeble men of, what are these Jews doing, these feeble Jews? You know what feeble means? See, he's taken the reality of where they are, and he's beating them down with it. Because feeble literally means withering. He's saying, look at these Jewish men. They have nothing. They are cut off from their God. God doesn't love them. If you remember, they're sitting there going back and they're saying, where is their God? Their temple's destroyed. Their city's destroyed. The gates are down. The walls are down. And they're mocking them and they're laughing at them and they're saying, they're so feeble. They are like a branch that has been cut off and thrown on the ground. What's it going to do? It's going to just die. And he says, look at your feeble attempts to accomplish something. You're nothing. You're nobody. That's what they're saying. Boy, how effective is that when they can look around and they have to hold on by faith to what God says they are because their circumstances, you know what? They hear that and they look around and it sounds true, doesn't it? It looks true, doesn't it? That's how the devil works. See, Nehemiah came with a different message. The Lord has not forgotten you. It looks like he has. He has not. We are where we are because of the choices we made. It wasn't about his love. It wasn't about his patience. He was completely patient. He tried time and again and time and again and time and again, and we kept sinning and we kept chasing other gods. He did this not because he hates us, but because he loves us, and his desire is that we will come back to him. That's the truth. But oh, ridicule works so good, and it can be so effective. Sambala, I mean, when you read it, it goes on and it says, are they going to restore it for themselves? What, do they think they're going to make something of themselves? These people that have nothing? He goes on and he just keeps compounding. He keeps adding on. He says, are they going to offer sacrifices? You see how they're mocking them? To who? To the God that abandoned you? The God that forsook you? The God who isn't nearly as great as our gods that conquered you? I find it interesting that they say, can they finish in a day? You know what they were recognizing? Man, these dudes are going fast. You can, listen, Fear drives the people that seek to discourage us. These men were afraid of what God was doing. They were afraid of what it meant for Jerusalem to become the city that it once was. And they even start mocking the progress. What, do they think they can accomplish this in a day? Listen, what a silly, stupid thing to say, but you see how it could discourage those men? These men were building a wall as quick as anybody'd ever build a wall. And he's even using that to be critical. And then, I mean, he just keeps heaping it on. I love Tobias steps up and he's like, we don't need an enemy to come in and build your wall. He's saying your wall is so sorry that we don't need an army to knock it down. What do we need? Just a fox to run up and jump on it. And it'll fall over. Why? Because you know what they were making the wall out of? They said the dust heap that was left from the first time they were conquered. He says, you're just picking up broken pieces and trying to make a wall out of rubble, out of nothing. Your wall's trash. Your wall's garbage. It's just what was. And it's all burned up and it's all broken. And you think that you're going to make something out of it? Doesn't all that sound true? Doesn't all that look true? Ridicule. He ridiculed the workers, the work itself, the materials, the finished product. And when that wasn't enough, then they started to overwhelm and attack. That's what else the devil does to discourage us. He overwhelms us. You see, it was overwhelming for them because they realized that they are completely surrounded by people that are their enemies. And word started to get to them that the intention of these people, you see it beginning in verse 7. He says that as the walls began to close, they kept getting more angry. And it said they conspired to come together and to fight Jerusalem. They weren't going to let them build because they thought to themselves, if we come in to fight them, what will they have to stop doing? They'll have to stop building. And we're going to distract them. We're going to discourage them. We are going to stop the work that's moving. And you see, what they didn't realize is that God knows, and God made sure that Nehemiah knows. And what does he do? He begins to pray. He prays twice in this text. What does the discouragement do to the people? You see it in verse 10, and we're going to talk about it in a minute. And when you go to verse 11, it says not only did they seek to disturb them, but once they realized that they weren't really being effective because Nehemiah keeps praying and God keeps giving victory, it seems like every time they tried to come together to overwhelm them, they weren't really able to do it. So now they conspired not just to disturb. Now they put the word out that when you least expect it, you guys are going to be working and we're going to come in and we're going to kill you. That's intimidation. That is seeking to put fear into the hearts of the Israelites. Folks, when it gets like this, let me tell you what happens to us. We start to spiritually hyperventilate. We freak out. We're overwhelmed. We're being laughed at, mocked, ridiculed, told we can't do it. We look around. Man, that seems to make sense. This really is hard. I don't know if I'm really the guy. And we start getting so overwhelmed. I love what it actually says in verse 10 because it's a good description. He says, this is the heart of Jerusalem at this time. This is what's going on in Judah. What these men did was starting to have its effect. It was starting to discourage the people. It was starting to slow down the work. Nehemiah, by his own words, he says, we indeed seem to be despised by everybody. And the words that these men are speaking, it is starting to discourage the workers. He said, what is being said in Judah? Listen to the words. Thus it's said in Judah, the strength of the burden bearers is failing. There is so much rubbish. We ourselves are unable to rebuild the wall. Because of ridicule, attack, being overwhelmed, being intimidated. If the devil can't fool you or lie to you, then he will try to frighten you. And what is so sad is he doesn't even just use these heathens around them and these pagans around them, you know what he does? Even the people of God start to get in on it. And it says the Jews who weren't working in Jerusalem for whatever reason, it says 10 times they went to the city. And you know what they told them? You need to just stop. If you don't stop, you're going to die. And why don't you just stop? And why don't you just come home? They're on mission for God, and they are doing exactly what God told them to. And everybody around them, their enemies outside, even the ones they love inside, they're all saying the same thing. Why don't you quit? Why don't you stop? That's a hard place to live, isn't it? Nobody believes that you heard the voice of God and you're doing His will. And you can't stop. Because when God says do something, what do? You do it. Most people don't realize what a tool the devil has in discouragement. It causes us to lose our strength. It causes us to lose our vision. It causes us to lose our confidence. The thing about discouragement is this: it's universal. There's not a person in this room who hasn't attempted great things for God and been discouraged. It is universal. It is recurring. That means you overcome it once, and guess what? You'll have to overcome it again. It began with laughing at them. Then it became, we're going to fight against you to distract you, to keep you from building the wall. And if we can't do that, now we're coming and we're going to kill you. You see how it just keeps coming? It's universal. It's recurring. And the thing about discouragement is it's highly contagious. It's probably one of the worst diseases in the world. Because I don't know that anything is as contagious as discouragement. We have to be careful. We've got to recognize it, expect it, be ready for it. Know what the devil is using to lie to us, to frighten us. Discouragement makes us feel weak, it makes us feel burdened, it makes us feel overwhelmed, unable, afraid, vulnerable, and that's the way the devil would have it. So thirdly, how do we survive it? Number one, expect criticism. Be ready. Number two, learn to recognize the tools he uses to discourage us, ridicule, attack, overwhelming us, intimidating us, discouraging us. How do we survive it? Number three. Well, folks, notice I put this first because Jeremiah put it first. And he put it most often. You know what he did? He prayed. Again, prayer is usually the last thing we do. Normally when we get discouraged, we're going to do a lot of things, but usually prayer isn't one of them. We might fight back. We might scream. We might yell. We might quit. And for many of us, the first thing is never to just stop and to pray. And it is what we need the most. In the very moment that you feel overwhelmed, you need to pray. In the very moment that you feel weak, you need to pray. In the very moment that you feel burdened, you need to pray. When you feel unable, when your cry becomes the cry of these people, we can't do it. I can't rebuild the wall. God, I can't do what you're asking me to do. The moment that that creeps in, don't go talk to somebody else. Seeking counsel is a good thing, but it's not the first thing. The first thing is pray. What a prayer from Nehemiah, my goodness. We call this an imprecatory prayer, okay? Imprecatory sounds like a big word. It's not. It just means curse, to curse. And when I say curse, it doesn't mean he prayed cussing, okay? That's our English word, curse. It means like in the Old Testament, in the New Testament, blessings and curses. Blessings and curses. And so it is a prayer of cursing. And so when you hear that, that's kind of off-putting. But realize that throughout the Scripture, many characters prayed imprecatory prayers. And we have what we call imprecatory psalms, which literally some of the psalms that you read, it is like, Lord, I want you to defend your name. I want you to break the teeth of your enemies. I mean, it's like tough stuff, right? And so you read this and you almost think, wow, can you pray like that for somebody? And I want you to understand the heart of Nehemiah. He's not praying this because he's bitter. He's not praying this because he's angry. He's not praying this because his feelings are hurt. He is praying this because he knows God's will is for the wall to be built, and anything standing in the way of that, he is asking God to deal with. And folks, understand this. God will deal with it. The last place you need to be is standing between God and his will, trying to stop it. It's like trying to put your hand out and stop a train. Nehemiah knows it. You know what Nehemiah prays? It's amazing. He says, "Hear, O God, how we are despised." He's not telling God something he doesn't know. He's just relating to God his heart and his burden. And he's saying, "Return to them their reproach on their own heads and give them up for plunder in a land of captivity." That's the first place in Scripture we say, "I'm rubber, you're glue. Whatever you do to me is going to bounce off and stick to you," right? That's pretty much what he said. What you do to me and what you say to me, may it come about in your life. Because think about it. He's saying, you don't know what it's like to be displaced in a land that isn't yours, to be in captivity. You see, most times when we are discouraging to people and we are not giving constructive criticism, the reality is it's because we have forgotten to put ourselves in the place where other people are. Rather than compassion, we feel disdain. You ever do that to somebody? You ever see them struggling and you are so highly critical and you forget what it's like to struggle in that same thing? He is hoping that their eyes will be opened if they get put in the position that they are in, because you know what it took for the children of Israel to be drawn back to God, don't you? The very thing he just prayed on them. See, we see it as such a negative. Nehemiah understood the people of God wouldn't be where they are today building a wall if they hadn't gone into exile and had to face this God that they're shaking their fist at. And he goes on and says, "Do not forgive their iniquity. Do not let their sin be blotted out before you, for they have demoralized the builders." What he is saying there is, he is recognizing what all of us have to recognize as we get before the Lord and pray about other people. That when they're standing in the way of what God's will is for your life, understand they are not sinning against you, they are sinning against him. Understand it is not a lack of respect for you, it is a lack of respect for him. How many times did Moses go to the Lord and pray about the children of Israel, and everything on the pages that we read says they are being disrespectful to Moses. They're not responding to Moses' leadership, and all the frustration of Moses, he never goes in and says, "Lord, they're not listening to me." What he always realizes is, "Lord, they're not listening to you." Sometimes we've got to get back to that place where if we are confident about what God's will is, we've got to do it. You say, well, and again, I want you to know, it's not just your enemies. Do you realize that there are children, there are teenagers, there are 20-somethings and 30-somethings who, when they are called of God to go on the mission field, do you realize that it's not just the world that's going to say, "Why are you doing that?" Sometimes it's people in their own church. Do you realize the number of times young people go to their parents and they say, "I feel a call of God on my life," and the parents literally look at them and say, "Well, that's not my plan for you. I wanted better for you." Parents, are you ready to let go of your kids and let God have them? You ready to let them go to a foreign country? You ready to let, because many of you aren't, and God's going to call them because that's what God does. That's who God is. And you're sitting back and you're thinking, well, man, are they going to go on the mission field and have nothing? No, they will go on the mission field and have everything that you don't have. We got to get it straight in our heads about when God is moving and praying for God to be faithful. It seems harsh, but he wants them to turn, and he recognizes that they are standing in front of a God who has absolute control, and his will be accomplished. Not only can we pray, but when Satan discourages, you know what we have to do? We have to encourage. When fear strikes the people around us, we have to go in and make sure that we are encouraging and reassuring them. Folks, we cannot let fear and discouragement go unchecked. You see, I told you about your superpower. How cognizant are you of the people around you that need your words of encouragement? What about people around you who aren't saved? You ever notice that sometimes we can be so rough on unsaved people? Why? Because we're so frustrated. Because we want to see them saved. And we forget that it's not us who saves. Who saves? God and God alone. And we get so frustrated. Have you ever found yourself actually talking down or belittling or totally speaking in a discouraging manner towards a person who can't see things the way you see things? Why? Because they don't have the Spirit of God in you and in them like you have in you. And we get so frustrated and we don't realize that, you know what, we're standing in the way by our discouragement. Folks, what people need is our encouraging words, our building them up. I love what he says here. He gathers the people and he keeps speaking to them. He keeps telling them, we've got to keep working. He keeps telling them that we got to keep going because God called us to this task. In fact, what he does, thirdly, and this is how we survive criticism and discouragement, he directed their attention to the Lord. He literally goes back and says of God what he said in chapter 1. If you remember in chapter 1, he was praying, and what he prayed was, God, you are awesome. God, you are great. God, you rule over the universe. You are sovereign. There's nothing that happens that you don't control. You are the Lord of the heavens. And if we are saved, we will be saved by your strong hand. Isn't that what he prayed? Well, you know what? He hadn't forgotten it. And he directed the people back. He said, quit listening to the voices around us and listen to the voice that called us. And folks, we have to learn to do that. Let me tell you, the only thing that will get rid of fear is faith. And you know what the reality is? Let this sink in. Fear and faith cannot exist in the same heart. Get back in the Word of God. Get back on your knees in prayer. I love the way Warren Wiersbe put it. He said, the remedy for discouragement is always the Word of God. When you feed your heart and mind with the Bible's truth, you regain your perspective and you find renewed strength. Amen. We also have to keep working. If you're going to survive the discouragement, it means you can't get off the wall. You can't stop working. That's what the enemy wants. That's what they're expecting you to do. But we are responsible to the Lord to do the work that he's called us to do, no matter the circumstances. No matter how it looks, no matter what others are saying. Literally what he's saying, when we keep working, it's saying that you have to trust God, but be alert to what the enemy is doing. We need two things when we do the work of God: deep trust and diligent effort. Notice the order I put those. Deep trust in God, faith in God that drives out fear, faith in God that keeps us committed to the call of God on our life, that keeps us from quitting. And once we find that deep trust and faith, guess what comes behind it? Diligent work. We will get back on the wall and we will work with all of our heart. I love what it says. It says the wall was built to half its height, but the hearts of the people was still in the work. The walls were half height. Their hearts were wholehearted, right? Not half-hearted. They were giving it their all, even in the midst of all the circumstances that were swirling around them. That's the courage that we are supposed to have, the faith that we are supposed to have as believers in Jesus Christ. We build and we battle all at the same time. Just because there's a battle raging doesn't mean, just because times are hard, just because you're misunderstood, just because you're discouraged, it doesn't mean you stop the work that God has called you to do. The greatest way to overcome it is not to stop. Keep going. You say, well, that sounds like you're asking us to burn it at both ends. That's what it looks like Nehemiah is asking the people. We're going to build and we're going to fight at the same exact time. So you keep a sword in one hand and a trowel in the other. You sling mud as long as you can, then you swing that sword when you have to. Most of us think we can only do one of those things at a time. Well, I'm discouraged. I need to quit. Well, I'm discouraged. I need to stop. Well, I'm discouraged. I think I'm going to back away. You know what God's saying? Why? It's hard. That's ministry. It's lonely. Talk to Jesus about it. He knows. He knows. I can tell you this. I'm glad all these things didn't stop Jesus from the cross. Why should it stop us? Because you know what he goes on and says here? He finishes with, look out for one another. If you want to know how to survive discouragement, it really has a lot, not just with prayer and all the other things that we've mentioned, but looking out for one another. I love the way he finishes. He simply says, listen, I'm going to be here and I'm going to have a trumpet with me. And whenever there's trouble, we're going to blow the trumpet. And wherever that trumpet is at that moment, he's going to be where the trouble is. And when the trumpet blows, what are the people supposed to do? Stop what they're doing and go to help. Folks, I can't think of a more beautiful picture of the Church of Jesus Christ. They were working on a wall that is 2.5 miles around, so you got a person here, and you got a person a mile or more that way. And it says that when you hear the trumpet, it means that someone is under attack, they're being discouraged, they're being intimidated, all the things we talked about, and you know what he says? Stop what you're doing and run to that person. And we're going to battle together. You say, well, that's your job, Aaron. No, no, no. That's how so many people in this church get discouraged because the pastor didn't do this, the pastor didn't do that. Folks, it's not about the pastor doing it. It's about all of us doing it together. I can't minister to all of you. I can't. I can't be what all of you need. But all of you can be to one another what each one of you need, and that's what the body's supposed to be. Equipped, ready to run when the trumpet sounds. To help one another, to carry one another's burdens, to encourage one another. All the one another's of Scripture, that's what we get to do when we hear the trumpet, right? Literally, the thing that was so impactful for me that he said that meant a whole lot when I read it was, if you noticed, he basically said that you have to fight for one another knowing that God is fighting for us. He says, don't be afraid, verse 14. Remember the Lord is great and awesome, and listen to him. He says, you're not fighting for you. Who are you fighting for? Your brothers, your sisters, your sons, your daughters, your wives, your houses. Because you see, as we're doing God's will, you see what we're doing, right? We're emissaries. We're ambassadors. We are those who are taking life to people who are dead. When you stop, it's not what happens to you. It's what happens to those around you who need the gospel. If God's will for you right now is to work on your marriage and you get discouraged and people say, oh, I'll give up, and oh, it ain't worth it, and you're hearing all this stuff, it's you sticking to what God told you and doing it, not just for you, but doing it for your sons and your daughters and your wife, your husband. Never giving up, because when you give up, it's not just about you, it's about all those around you who God has sent you to. As Kevin comes this morning, I want to just remind you of these very simple words. And I want you to think about them, and I want you to just let the words that I'm about to speak to you sink in a minute. No matter how dark the sky is, no matter how discouraging the circumstances are, no matter how desperate the situation is that you are facing, never forget this truth. God is there. That's the easiest thing to forget. Our instinct is to say, where are you, God? And you know what he's saying? I've been where I've always been. I'm on my throne. In heaven, I'm on my throne in your heart. I told you I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. So no matter how dark your circumstances, he says to you, he's saying to you today, I am here. And he is a God, listen, that is too good to forget, and he's too great to fail. He's here, and his mighty arm rules over this universe. He will redeem all who will let him, and he will reinforce any who respond to him in faith and obedience. Father, Lord, I know from my own personal experience, I've lived in this sermon, discouraged, ready to quit, ready to give up on the calling that you've placed in my life, ready to walk away from Hepzibah, ready to walk away from First Baptist Geneva, every church you've ever put me in. Lord, I've gotten to the place where I had to decide, am I going to just stop? God, I thank you for reminding me that you're here, that you're strong enough, that you're able. And Lord, men didn't call me, you did. People don't determine my path, you do. I don't need the blessing of this world. I need to hear the words, well done, thou good and faithful servant. And Father, when I learned to live for an audience of one, it changed, Lord, my heart so I could stand at the wall and do what you've asked me to do. And Lord, I pray, Lord, that people that are in that lonely moment, discouraged, Lord, that you would take away their fear, their anxiety, their hopelessness, their feelings of burden and weakness, overwhelmed, they feel unable. God, I pray that today all those things that bring fear, replace it with faith. Let them see, let them believe with all their heart, my God is awesome and he is able. He's here. Father, there may be some here today, they don't know you as Lord and Savior. Call them today. Let them know that you love them. Let them know that they are forgiven because of the cross. Let them know that, Lord, you will wrap your arms around them and give them life and liberty to follow you and to serve you and to live the life you created them for. Lord, just as that man said on the video, you redeem us for a purpose. God, may they find today the forgiveness of sins because they believe you died for them, and may they surrender to you, Lord, to fulfill the purpose for which you redeemed them. And God, give them the courage today to just share with the world they've accepted you. Lord, this sermon in so many ways is for the church. It's for us that are sitting in this room that are saved. And God, may you challenge our hearts today. Lord, some of us have already given up. Lord, let them stand back up and take their place at the wall. Many of them have already quit. Let them say no more. And Father, many in this room, Lord, they just needed that gentle reminder that they don't need to be the source of discouragement in the lives of people. They are to build and to encourage and to love and to be compassionate and to be merciful, to speak truth, but to always be sure that it's laced with love. So, Father, be with us. There are so many things that you desire to say in this room. As we sit and as we pray, Lord, speak to us. And if there's one who needs to join, if there's one who needs to come and receive Christ, or tell the world that they've received Christ, Lord, let them come in this moment. These altars are open. Lord, thank you for receiving us and letting us pray to you in Jesus' name.